report in closed session first. Yeah. So reporting out to closed session, we have nothing to report. Are there any public comments for closed session? Okay, if there being none, we're going to adjourn closed session. And now I get to call this meeting to order here for Sutter County. So I want to welcome everybody to the May 8, 2018 board meeting. And when we call this to order, we'll start with roll call, please.
Supervisor Flores. Here. Supervisor Hunter. Here. Supervisor Miller. Here. And Supervisor Pine. Here.
Great. If I can have everybody please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance and our invocation. Stay standing for the invocation. Please join me in the pledge. I pledge
allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Standing for our invocation, we said by Dave Brenna from the Church of Glad Tidings.
Heavenly Father, we ask you for your blessing today. We come together and pray for those that are in authority, as your word commands us, that we might live lives of righteousness and peace. We thank you, Lord, that you've promised that if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives generously to those who ask. And we do that. We pray for these who are in government over our area. We pray that you bless them with wisdom and grace together. We ask it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you. Everybody, you may be seated. Supervisors. State law provides that no action may be taken on any item not appearing on the posted agenda. And I do have some public comment cards, so as I call your name, please come on up to the podium. And we'll start first with Becky Jennings. Becky?
I'm bringing water, sorry.
That's okay.
Good afternoon. Members of the board, I am here to talk about your fabulous Washington, D.C. trip. I have talked to many members of this community who think it's a fabulous idea, so I'm in agreement with that. What I am not in agreement with is that we took Mr. Whitaker there this year. With all the current problems he has going on, if you Google Sutter County, he comes up in number one, number two, number three slot. If you Google his name, it's all you find. My concern is there are hundreds of people in this community that are outraged that you haven't taken action. I realize you've been advised by your attorneys to not talk on the subject, but I also know you've been told you could censure or remove him from committees and chairs like the Children's and Family Commission. Out of respect for the citizens of this community, I respectfully request that you take an action so that we are not an embarrassment to the rest of the world. After we made a big deal of getting in Washington, D.C., I know you're not proud of the fact that he went with you or you would have put his picture on your website. His name is there, his picture is not. So let's take a look and make sure that we're treating the citizens of this community with as much respect as I believe you are showing Mr. Whitaker. Okay, that's all I have to say. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Okay, the next public card I have is Mr. Bob Renton.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Bob Renton. Reside near Live Oak, and trying to get something up there. Trying to get a graphic up on the screen. Also, I own a family home now on Hunt Road near Yuba City, and start with a question. Are there anybody here who enjoys paying their sales taxes when they buy something in Union City? I'm one person who shops primarily in Union City. Thank you. I wonder if we have anyone else here that might shop within the city limits of Union City. A few brave souls. All right, thank you. This message is for Union City shoppers. And I hope my message does not cause any medical problems for people in attendance. Yuba City senior staff has done some serious planning about possibly boosting the sales tax. A study was commissioned that might lead to a sales tax boost if Yuba City Council approves the idea. The study included a question to gauge voter acceptance of a 1% boost. Of course, it would affect everyone who shops in Yuba City. And only registered voters inside city limits will be able to vote on this measure.
Yes, Mr. Rim, can you speak a little closer into the microphone, please?
Sorry.
Thank you.
Only registered voters inside city limits would be able to vote on this, but it would affect just about everybody who shops inside Union City. Union City senior staff likes to call this a local revenue measure. The hypothetical ballot measure is on the screen up above for everyone to see, and I passed it out to the supervisors so each of you can keep your own copy. Please review the graphic. I was prevented from showing this graphic to the public at the last city council meeting on May 1. And again, it describes a hypothetical ballot measure and gives the ballot language tested in the survey, and it describes the purpose. Top of the list, police and fire protection. Very good attention drivers. However, when presented as a general fund measure, it can be used for anything the city council wants. And a general fund measure only needs 50% plus one to pass.
And Mr. Renton, I just want to let you know, we're going to be adhering strictly to the 3-minute rule today. So you're right there. I'll give you a few more seconds to wrap it up, and we can hear from you at another time if you'd like. Right. I appreciate your comments today.
Bottom line is, I ask everyone to let their supervisors know how they feel on this issue, pro or con. May you want a boost. I kind of doubt it. Anyhow, I ask you to contact your supervisors and those supervisors to contact city officials and let them know how they feel.
Okay, great. Thank you.
I have form letters available.
All right. Thank you all for your time. Thank you. Appreciate it. Next speaker is Singh. Oh, JRTR. Or Singh.
Teachers, not less than 300 years ago in modern history, six were called upon to to defend the freedom of the violently oppressed. And right now, so appropriately so, is the holiest of all anniversary celebrations for all Sikhs around the world, as we have recently and are currently celebrating Baisakhi, the birth of Sikhism, and the Khalsa, who represent the embodiment of God in all beloved Sikhs who are ordained to protect truth. And within the Khalsa, that foundation, we are given birth to Singh, Lion, King of all beings on this earth, which is the birthright ordained bestowed by God upon all Sikh men, and we are charged as warriors to defend. We are ordained as relentless seekers of truth and with extreme conviction, and we proudly rise to our divine calling to protect all our Gors. Gor, as princess, represents our daughters, our wives, and our sisters. That is our core value, that is our core existence, is to protect our daughters and our women from illicit behaviors. And make no mistake, this is all based upon demonstrated, proven experience over 300 years. And now, so appropriately, ladies and gentlemen, for all six, we declare that we are here to stamp out the sicknesses in our community. We are prepared to take full responsibility of the man we gave rise to, and we are ready to take responsibility to protect the daughters who have been injured, and the victims, and without reservation, and without hesitation. So now, you are no longer, Mr. Whitaker, welcome at any temple in this community. Your name has been shot to the Golden Temple in Amritsar, the headquarters, the Vatican of the Sikhs, and all Sikh warriors, sir, are on notice with your face, your picture, and your crimes of victims here in this town.
I'm going to ask you to wrap it up, sir.
Thank you, Dan. And I, please excuse my passion for not anger, because I am rejoiced to be here today, and I thank you, Jim, for giving the Sikhs the opportunity here to rejoice our history and stamp out the sickness and disease. And I will share one last thing, Dan.
We need to.
I will share one last thing. I speak not from other hearsay. I speak to children I spoke with. And I also speak to a person by the name of Tiara, who you tried to victimize, sir. My blood.
Okay, we need to wrap it up, sir.
So be rest assured, the Sikhs are going to protect all the children, all our mothers in this community. Thank you very much, sir.
Maybe you should have kept your hands off my knees.
Did
I
hear your mouth shut?
Why
don't
you make
me?
Paper,
your friend. Can I have water, please? No, I'm not going to accept any more outbursts in the meeting room, or I will have you dismissed, okay? Okay, next comment. Cindy Storman, please.
Two daughters myself, as a person who's listened to the other girls who've been touched, and I'm not a person that's just going to listen to rumors in the community. That's not who I am. I don't think anything is fact until I've seen documents, or I've seen proof of said facts. I was given documents to read, and these come not only from the most recent incident where a girl was touched and inappropriate sexual manner by Mr. Whitaker in January, but these documents go clear back to 1998. There's an investigative report from Yuba City High School where they had an investigation done on an incident where two different individuals, one a child and one another staff member, in 1998 reported that they were assaulted by Mr. Whitaker. These aren't lies. This is public information requests that you can get the proof of yourself. This isn't a rumor or something made up. It's really disturbing. These people had reported it and reported it, and the investigative report from 1998 comes back and says sustained, that it did in fact happen. And the most recent incident with the girl in January, this poor 14, 15-year-old girl, I've heard her called a liar, I've heard her called greedy, I've heard her called all kinds of things. Well, you know what? Her investigation, the one that was done by the Yuba City School District, they hired an outside law firm to investigate the matter. And the neutral outside parties came back and said, yes, these allegations did hold merit. And it did happen. And every person I've spoken with lately keeps saying to me, why is he still our supervisor? I've never met Mr. Whitaker personally. I don't know him. All I know is what I've seen. I don't know this person personally, but I'll tell you, I've heard a lot of stuff about he's done great things for the community. He's raised so much money. He's paid for somebody's lunches on a cheer trip. He's done this. You know what? Our daughters are not for sale. I don't care how much money you've raised. Thank you.
Okay, next speaker card is Jessica. Is it McKelney?
McElroy,
I'm sorry.
Good afternoon. My name is Jessica McElroy. I am a concerned citizen that lives here in Yuba City, and I am also a part of the 20 people that stepped forward to start the recall process for Mr. Whitaker. I was very active with many other parents in regards to having him removed from his teaching position at Yuba City Unified. For quite some time, I felt disappointed that the school district didn't do what was appropriate to remove him from his teaching privilege. I'm proud to say that with the help of our work, helping bring to light many of the things that have been brushed under the rug, that after 20 years of all of these allegations, many to be documented, and what we consider to be true, and I'm sure Mr. Whitaker knows at some level that they are true.
I'll have
a conversation, dear.
It's my turn
to talk. Thank you.
Thought you were asking me a question. I'm my
apologies.
You can continue your comments.
Thank you. I am proud that Yuba City Unified did the right thing after 20 years. However, in those 20 years, many and many children were fell victim to gender. In the city of Yuba City, we have the power to do the right thing. The members of District 4 are able to vote to remove him from this position of power to which we have seen he has chosen to abuse. Mr. Whitaker does not belong in the position that he has. Something that we hear often in reference to children is that it takes a village to raise them. It also takes a village to protect him, and we need to work together to remove him from this position. According to the CDC, the statistics as of 2008 in January, it states that more than half of women are victims of unwanted harassment or sexual advances and or violence. That means probably half of the women in this room have experienced some type of unwanted acts, such as those displayed by Mr. Whitaker on a regular basis during his teaching. We all need to work together to remove this person and from his position because he does not deserve to be there. I also have not ever met Mr. Whitaker. I've never met any of the people, even to this day, that have stated he's done these things to them. However, because there is so much proof and documentation about what's happened, I feel that we need to work together and believe what we're seeing. This is not fake news. This is real cases that happened. So we need to work together to remove him from this position. Thank you so much. Also, before I finish, I do have a petition available with me. If there's anybody that would like to meet afterwards to sign, I'd be more than happy to step out with you and take your signature. Thank you so much.
Okay,
The next speaker card is Shirley Gallo.
My name is Shirley Gephardt, and I'm here to tell you that those allegations are false against Mr. Jim Whitaker. For one thing, he has not had his say in court, and you are proving him guilty without a cause. And you're trying to make everybody else believe that he's guilty, and he will have his say, and he will be exonerated. And this is all hearsay. And for one thing, there has to be a statute of limitation as to how far back they can go on all these false allegations. And you can laugh all you want on this stuff. And there's nothing that can be proved. All of this stuff that is written has anonymous. There's dates and no names. And it just says anonymous from 1993 to 98. And Jim Whitaker is a very honorable person. So you can just state all these false things and think that it's true, but all it is that it's about money and just trying to get in on this money for a person's reputation you have ruined and his family life and everything. So you can think about this and karma will get you at the end. Thank you.
Changing the church sign, and a police car drove up and said, the police came out and said, hey, you need to get to this household. When I got there, I discovered that one of my parishioners had killed himself, and I was there to comfort the family. And I was thinking, I didn't sign up for this, but you know, I prayed about it, and I got the strength to take care of it. I think you, four of you supervisors, are in the same position. You've been placed in a very difficult, almost impossible position. And all I can ask you guys is to do the right thing. I know all of you. And I'm just asking you to do the right thing. It may not be easy, but you guys are men of integrity. I'm just asking you to dig deep, do the right thing. Thank you.
Okay, that ends our public comment. And now we're going to move to special presentations. So I'd like to call the chairman of the Juvenile Justice Delinquency and Prevention Commission up to the podium.
She and her team worked through the nights to protect those who could not protect themselves. It's important to remember that they are people's children in our community that are being rehabilitated, and the families were not able to ensure their safety during this chaotic time. And as a parent, I can only imagine how difficult it was for all of the families of the children that you were protecting and keeping safe. Ms. Beth Weber and her team rose to the challenge seamlessly and unselfishly behind the scenes. These facilities house children from multiple counties, covering many jurisdictions, and this team deserves accolades for their professionalism and rapid response. As the Sutter County Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention Commission, we would like to take a moment to acknowledge and thank you and all of your staff, Teresa, for your commitment to the children and all of the impacted communities. Thank you.
Because, you know, if a grower called her on her personal phone on the weekend, she took the call.
If I called her when she wasn't on duty to help me out with a pesticide drift or anything that happened, Jan would come. She would help anybody in the office. She's taking care of people's pets at their home when they're out of town. She's helping foster spay and neutering stray cats all over town. Jan Kendall is the example that we should live by for an awesome public servant to the citizens of Sutter County. Thank you.
I'd just like to say I was one of those 27,000 more than once that went to Jan's class. She is an outstanding public servant, giving to the community. And the recycle jug thing is a fantastic thing to preserve our environment. All those jugs are recycled, turned into pellets, and reused to make like plastic benches and stuff like that. But it's an incredible thing. 1 million pounds almost been recycled now. I have a bunch waiting.
Yes.
For next year, for this coming year. But it's truly an incredible servant to our community. Jan is an avid gardener, as many of you are aware. She also came and got cuttings from my community bushes. But anyway, we're going to miss Jan. Great service to our community and our county. And we'll do it this year. Thank you.
Thank you.
Stand here for your presentation. Okay, this is in honor of proclamation for National Foster Care Month, which is May of 2018. Whereas Sutter County relies on foster homes due to the number of troubled children found to be at risk and being removed from their own homes because of sexual abuse, physical abuse, parental absence, incapacity, or exploitation. And whereas Sutter County recognizes that all children need love, support, security, and a safe place to call home. And whereas Sutter County has 166 children in out-of-home care, including foster homes, group homes, and residential treatment facilities. And whereas Sutter County has children placed with foster parents in counties of Sutter, Butte, Fresno, Volusia, Nevada, Placer, Sacramento, Stanislaus, Yolo, and Yuba, who have opened their hearts and their homes to the children of Sutter County in times of crisis, providing a safe, loving, and supportive home environment due to their commitment to the needs of children. Now, therefore, and be it resolved that the Sutter County Board of Supervisors hereby declare May as National Foster Care Month. So I'd like to congratulate all of you and thank you.
Challenges can be great or they can be small, the blessings are unbelievable, and so to have the community supporting us is very important.
Thank you for coming.
Since we were breached, none of this was
qualifying for any payout from your state, the insurance company. So I have a question. So once this is initiated, there's a service fee that goes along with it that you mentioned, right?
Correct.
And then and it goes, it's updated automatically by the company to make sure that it's up to date.
Correct. Yes, we've been the internet circuit, or our internet, is continuously monitored, and whenever there's any signs of an attack, we put those attacks, they mitigate them, and they watch them, and if there is any further issues, they contact us when they're ready to turn it on. We've had, I think, over the last few months, at least 3 or 4 incidents that have been mitigated monthly.
Okay. And that's a fixed rate for what period of time?
So a fixed rate for 36 months, and it's under county agreed contract, which is a competitively bid contract that is used by state agencies, government agencies.
Okay. Thank you. Are there any comments from the board? Any further comments from the board? Okay.
Move for approval recommendation.
Okay, is there a second? Okay, we have a first and second. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed or abstentions? There being none, the motion carries. Thank you, Dan. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, next items. We're going to do the next two items sort of together here. So I'd like to call up Scott Thurman, Jana Shannon, and Scott Mitnick. The next two items are the approval of the ad hoc committee recommendation for the homeless shelter site and then approval of the staff recommendation for the homeless shelter site. I think we'll do sort of a combined, since they're sort of interrelated, we'll do a combined presentation of that. Okay. Hi, Scott.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair and supervisors. We are here today to present a multi-pronged report regarding the activities of the ad hoc homeless shelter site location committee. And within that, just a little side note, just as a consultant working with this committee, I believe that they are to be commended for the work that they've done. But not only the result they came up with, but also and their willingness to hear each other out, to come to a consensus. They went through a process that was very professional, very courteous to one another, so I appreciate the work that they've done. We have here today the chair and the vice chair of that committee, and they're going to share with you the staff report or the committee report, and also you're going to receive additional staff recommendations.
Thank you, Scott. Yeah.
Wasn't I just here?
Yes, you were. Welcome back.
Well, things progressed rather rapidly after our last visit. As you're aware, the committee was charged with the review of 14 sites initially. 4 of the most optimal sites were located within the Sutter County Airport Comprehensive Airport Land Use Plan area. As such, there was a problem with the zoning and with the FAA requirements that would delay any kind of action. That it didn't make sense to pursue those. The committee took into consideration when considering a site the proximity to residences and schools, infrastructure, was it close and able to hook up to water, sewer, and power, access to services and transportation, the ability to develop into a shelter quickly, zoning and general plan requirements. The final consideration is probably the most important. Actually, I added in zoning and general plan, so that was the final.
time of it. The ability to develop into a shelter quickly was our number one requirement. We wanted to get something done as quickly as possible, and we all know that there are zoning requirements and public hearings and things all that take time. So looking at the things that would necessitate the least amount of pushback, those were the sites that we pursued. Having some form of temporary facility will allow the board to then effectively review and choose a site for a more permanent long-term facility, as well as time to develop partnerships with the business community, our citizens, and the various faith communities that already serve the underhoused in one capacity or another. At its final meeting on April 16th, our committee approved the following recommendation to the board. And that recommendation was to recommend one of two sites, Yuba Sutter Behavioral Health and or the Church of Glad Tidings, as temporary site location or locations, and that the sites that are the most fiscally responsible and can be developed most rapidly be selected. We're recommending these two sites based on the committee's understanding of the infrastructure, zoning issues, and so forth. Design and negotiation will be up to the board and the staff. As a reminder, the committee was not charged by the board to review and address site layout details. Rather, the committee was charged to find a recommended site location only. If the board concurs with the committee that on the recommended sites, it will need to direct county staff to conduct the necessary due diligence to determine estimated costs, operating costs, staffing, timing, and so forth, and report back to the board with findings and recommendations. The Board of Supervisors may suggest other sites to be reviewed by the community, the committee, or staff. The board may also direct the committee to continue on in an advisory capacity, which, as far as I understand, most of the committee is willing to do. The board may also decide not to consider any sites and direct staff not to pursue a homeless shelter at all. No direct costs associated with continuing to review homeless shelter site locations exist at this time. This is just, we're in the review process. If the board directs staff to research the cost of establishing a homeless shelter on the recommended location, staff will come back on the estimated one-time cost of constructing such a facility and recurring costs to operate it. And I'm sure that some of these issues will be addressed by CAO Mitnick. And Ryan, our vice chair, has his own comments to add to this report.
Great, thank you, Jen.
Thank you very much, Chair Shannon, and I you did an excellent job. For some reason, I don't say that much, except CAO Mitnick is going to address this in the staff report, and I want to three that we perhaps continue on, committee, continue on as an advisory capacity on a needed basis. And I think many of the members of this committee stand ready to act as ambassadors to the community. We can help coordinate nonprofits and the faith-based community. And I just want to thank Chair Shannon for leadership, and CAO Mitnick and county staff have been excellent. They answered hundreds of questions and great support during this process. So thank you very much. I especially want to thank the members of this committee. They're all volunteers, as you're aware. They're all dedicated to the health and well-being of this community. And it's exciting that we're moving along in the process. So thank you very much.
Thank you. I know there's two, so there's two items of action, but let's combine presentation and then we'll take action on each one. So Scott, Mr. Mitnick.
Mr. Chair, members of the board, thank you for your indulgence. The reason we have a separate staff report is because we have a recommendation, or a series of recommendations, in addition to what the board's direction to the committee was. So the committee did excellent work. Many of the members are here in the audience this afternoon. They have two recommendations for you to consider, two different sites, and The board's direction was to find a site and come back with a recommendation. So you can direct staff to pursue one or both of those sites or on other sites, as the committee chair articulated. So assuming that the board will give direction to pursue one or two or more sites, after you do that, then you would also need to direct staff to do three things here. And it's these are delineated in the staff report. One would be to conduct the necessary due diligence for the site or sites that you would like more information. By due diligence, we mean to sit down on the staff level and go through the different scenarios on each site, which could range from simply providing a space for homeless individuals to rest, very basic, just here's a spot on the ground, to a complete facility of some sort. We would come back and say, here are the options, here's how much that would cost in terms of a one-time construction cost or making the site available cost, as well as recurring operating costs, staffing, timing, etc., as well as bringing in nonprofits to perhaps run whatever type of operation there would be. We'd probably need about 2-3 months to do that, to come back. So that would be recommendation one. Recommendation two is for the board to provide direction to continue working on the long-term homeless management plan that the board approved on November 7th. We're just asking for reaffirmation of that. And then three, staff is recommending that you continue the ad hoc homeless shelter review committee to assist staff on an as-needed basis as we would go through the due diligence. And the reason we're asking for that is this is a wonderful committee. They're very dedicated. They express the desire to keep going, to be involved. And if the board is inclined, we would like to be able to take advantage of their knowledge and input. And they serve as a really good sounding board for certain ideas. So that's the staff follow-up and recommendation. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. First, I'll bring back the board. We do have public comment as well, but we'll start with the board questions, thoughts.
Public comment.
Okay, we'll start with public comment then. Steve Gimlin.
Board members, thank you, members of the community. Just wanted to address the proposed site of the dry tidings location. I heard a lady up here talking about one of their most, the highest concerns was speed. How quickly can it come into a homeless shelter? That's one of the biggest concerns that we have, because in that community where I happen to live and other members of this building live, it's not set up for that, right? They have to defend themselves. We have very little control. The budget for the county sheriff is low. I just think that the location, even to consider it, is ill-advised. I think that there's no adequate resources for people that might be there. I don't know. It doesn't typically sound clear what is proposed to go in there. I understand the county administrator was talking about developing that a little bit further. But I think the location is just not a great one because it's unsafe for the community members around it. Resources are not there. I think people that would be there as a homeless shelter would probably be trying to walk into town to and from, whether it's Live Oak or the city. Those pathways are not lighted, they're not safe. I don't know if that opens up the county to exposure in terms of people getting hit or run over or whatever might happen on those areas. And another thing I heard from the committee was that the ground out there may be donated for this purpose. And I think that may be a little bit short-sighted because you're trying to save thousands and for an issue that may end up costing us millions. So I think that the county should really take into consideration those things. Hopefully they're developed a little bit further before a decision is made. If you are going to make a recommendation for a temporary location tonight, we can certainly ask that be in town where the resources are there, can be shared amongst the city police and sheriff's department. Also, there's better access to health and behavioral health services that are all right there. They're certainly not readily available right there off the beach. Okay, thank you.
Good, thank you. Next public speaker is Elaine Miles.
Elaine Miles, and I want to say ditto to everything he said. I think that the committee's setup was too short. I think we need to have more information. And I personally would like to see the Live Oak Prior Women's Detention Area looked into. That is a more permanent housing type thing, not tents. The thing that we're missing is a long-term plan. And I really think we have to address this long-term. I've read everything about Orange County, about Los Angeles, all the problems that they're having. So I would like to see the committee kept in progress, looking at things deeper. Because this is going to cost us money, but hopefully it's going to save lives and save money. So thank you.
Thank you. Next public speaker would be Casey Kroon.
A little strange standing here about 12 years ago, I think, that I was in this building. My concern is that one of these sites is located in an ag zone area. They're on a septic system, and I don't know how you're going to solve that part. And it said something about a building being built and paid for by Sutter County, and I'm not sure if that's totally true. That could be an incorrect statement that was made by the reporter. But it seems like every time you try to grow a crop, I need a burn permit, I need a spray permit, I need a permit to apply nitrogen. And the list goes on. And when we start bringing facilities out in the agricultural zoned area, it's not going to help the farmers whatsoever. Plus, this place is several miles out of town, at least a week or three. And it just doesn't seem to make sense if it was built in that particular location. I'd also look long and hard, if I were you, look long and hard at what Sacramento has done. They have spent millions of dollars, and to my knowledge, they're not getting very good results. They're just moving from one place to the other. So with that, I thank you for your time.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Green. And I have a final speaker card of Justin McKelly.
Well, I have the unfortunate opportunity to follow Casey because representing the ag in our industry, the traffic that and the lack of infrastructure from bike lanes, sidewalks, you're going to cause an undue force to private property rights as you go through and using the levee system as a transient to connect them from the town. From my knowledge, most homeless shelters are operated on a nighttime basis and are asked the participants to go into the workforce, better off the community during the days, and you're picking one of your locations separated by miles of agriculture ag land without transit to there. Casey made a great point. That septic system, I would have to bet, is used engaged for a church with large crowds one day a week. They're regarding moving a large population of people to seek permanent residence. You have stormwater issues, you don't have drainage water, you have groundwater, as we all know what groundwater is, the Groundwater Safety Act. You're talking about building a large multi-use community relying on groundwater. Who knows the safety of the nitrogen? You're going to open yourself up to more long-term goals, stormwater, septic system, and just in general that you have no microphones, you have no way to use people to transit back and forth. Where the other option, in my understanding, is centrally located near a mental health facility, rehab facility, to where we can, as a community, help them out and get the ones that are willing and capable and have the capacity to get back to the workforce. The other ones that need a little bit more assistance to be close to the point of service endpoint. We are under service also by the sheriff. And now you're asking your ag crime sitting on the Farm Bureau board has been a big issue. You were asking us to give us headaches without the solutions to handle it. This is a countywide I am very sympathetic to the plight. I don't want to see our rivers destroyed. There has to be a long-term solution. But one isolated in the country doesn't sound like it should be considered the best idea.
Thank you. Thank you. Here, Pat, right. Oh, one more speaker.
You
should know me because I just gave you my card.
Oh. I'll take it from you now.
I'm on the speaker.
My name is Mr. Chairman and members of the board. Thank you for allowing us to speak. Ladies and gentlemen, I first want to thank the committee for the hours and energy they committed to this project. I mean, it's generally, they may disagree, but I think it's a thankless task and one that's wherever you turn, you face opposition. The old not in my backyard argument. There is no perfect place for what we're trying to accomplish here. Because it's a complicated problem, I've sat on the bench and I know from experience that the folks who need the help have a myriad of problems. The easiest one to solve is people who are down on their luck and really want a helping hand for the temporary period of time until they get back on their feet. There's another group who have serious emotional issues. There's another group who have serious drug issues. And so you can't just build one building, house them all in one building on one parcel and treat them in a camp. You just can't do that. The state hasn't figured it out, the nation hasn't figured it out. And so Sutter County is taking off a big chunk when they think that they can do that. Bless them if they can. The genesis of this problem, as you may know, started when the sheriff was asked to remove people from the river bottoms on private property. And then we get the federal court involved in it, ordering an injunction stopping that. And then the wisdom of the court tells them, just find a space to put people. That's all I'm asking you to do. Well, no clue what the court considers space, how to manage it, how many souls it can house, who gets in, who doesn't, who and for what reasons, and can someone be expelled, and then where do they go? All those questions unanswered. I'm running out of time, so I'm going to speed it up. We fear the almighty lawsuit. That's a mistake. You're in the lawsuit. Use the court. Go to the judge. Go to CRLA, whomever it is that's representing the homeless. Say, let's sit down and solve this problem. Go to the court. Say, we need to sit down with you, Your Honor, and find out what's going through your head. The find a space is a short-term road to nowhere. We need to know what you think, if we do it, you'll approve. And get some guidance instead of simply finding a site and then hoping it fits. The court is receptive to things like that. County Council should be talking to their opponent at CRLA and say, listen, we want to solve this problem. Let's see if we can meet with the court and talk it out. I encourage you to, I know you want a quick fix, and this is not going to be a quick fix. You may think you're getting one, but you're not. You're going to have to set something up that's going to fail. So try to put more thought into it and better planning. Thank you.
Okay, at this point, I'll bring back your board comment.
To the chair.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to say thank you to those of you that have decided to come in with your opinion today, because one of the problems that we as supervisors face on critical issues in particular sometimes is the apathy that we have unintended consequences after the decision is made. I think Mr. Hill's remarks were certainly in keeping. But I'd just like to say this morning, as I read the Appeal Democrat, it threw a red flag up to me because I thought, gee whiz, we're having a meeting this afternoon, and according to the little reporter that's usually pretty well informed, the county is going to establish a homeless mecca up at the Grand Tidings Church, and they're also considering 1 acre over by mental health. And I felt, geez, you know, somewhere along the line, they forgot to tell me about it.
And so I began getting phone calls, some of which, obviously, not in my backyard. Others, I think, I speak for a number of folks that have spoken to me. We are really tired of something called compassion fatigue. And we really are being forced to address this issue by a federal judge in Sacramento that says, find space. It doesn't have to be a hotel, a room, a structure. It just says space. So today, we're here simply in plain speak to talk about investigating the possibility of those sites mentioned. There's no deal that's been cut with Glad Tidings that I'm aware of. They simply, and we appreciate your offer of assistance. I believe personally that the nonprofits, as well as the faith-based organizations, as well as Marysville, Yuba City, a reluctant partner, Sutter County, and Yuba County, need to approach this problem as a community problem, not just to say, Sutter County, this is your problem because you're getting sued. So, we're forced into the issue of trying to find a solution, and as Mr. Hill has so aptly said, it's not an easy solution. But temporarily, in order to lift the injunction that we've been faced with by this federal judge, I'd like nothing better than to send a couple of our homeless down in his front lawn and have him say, you know, we don't have anywhere else to live, see what his reaction is to that. But the reality of the situation is, we're trying to find a way of studying this issue. We're not going to be voting on, yes, this is where we're going to go today, or we're going to build this place tomorrow. That's not our idea at all. We're simply trying to find the possibility. So the article in the newspaper this morning was rather alarming, and I can understand how one of the errors, the lady says, is 1.1 acre. Well, it happens to be 11 acres. Over by mental health. And there's discussion of intensity sorts. The Glad Tidings thing, I had a meeting with those folks at Glad Tidings. They're simply saying, how can we help if we can help? So there's an alarming article in the paper that I think got a lot of folks excited. But we're not here to make any decisions today other than let's continue to try to find a solution, not this is the solution. Thank you.
Thank you. Supervisor Coonan?
Yes, first of all, I'd like to thank the committee. It was a wide, diverse group of people from our community. I think they did an outstanding job. I can't thank you guys enough. I can't believe you guys were able to come to consensus on so many issues when such a diverse group of people, different opinions, I'm sure strong head opinions. But I think that we need to do a little more work on this issue. I would like to make a motion if that's appropriate at this point.
Let me give you a few more comments.
Okay. So I also think that we need to do more research on it, and I would agree with what Supervisor Solinger had to say as well. And we as a board need to get our hands around the situation a little better before we approve anything. Thank you.
Thank you, Supervisor Gunnage. Supervisor Berger.
The chair.
Yes.
We've had many discussions, many meetings on this issue. And some of the speakers you got up here today, you're right. It's not gonna happen just overnight. As you all know, it's a nationwide issue. And Supervisor Forrest and I, we talk about when we go back to Washington and we meet with homeless executives, and we say, can you show us a model, some type of model that's working somewhere in the United States? And I'll shake your head to, there is no model. We're like, wait a minute, what about the Yuba County model that they have? And they're like, it's a temporary fix. That's what it is, a temporary fix. And so, looking at this, obviously we don't want to do a knee-jerk reaction trying to just facilitate, a one-time fix. We want to look at the long-term goals here. And so, one of the things, as well as Supervisors have told you, is that I think we get caught up into the legalities of, homeless shelters, homeless sites, and putting all these people together. believe me, these people do not want to be put together. You know, they're not looking to go into fraternity or sorority or, you know, and house 90 people all in one building. It's just the homeless people that come up here and they're speaking, it's just, they come up here and they say, just leave us alone. You know, we want to be left alone. We're in the room box, just leave us alone. So I totally understand that. And so we have to, you know, take exception of what we need to do. Obviously, in Supervisor Cohen's district, you know, they are bordering that herbicide. And so, you know, it's imperative that, you know, we try to locate them in an area that is a place of rest. You know, we have also fishing guides that are on the river. They're saying that people are catching fish and eating fish are getting E. coli. And how are they getting E. coli? And I asked that question, how are they getting E. coli? And they're saying it's because of the feces that are coming down the river from homeless people. And it's not just happening here, it's also happening on the American River as well. And so, you know, so once again, we have to take the bigger picture.
I think everybody in this room doesn't mind giving somebody a hand up, okay? We don't mind giving somebody a hand up. And, you know, in general, we'll reach out and get somebody that needs it in need. Just, I will tell you that this issue is costing Sutter County a tremendous amount of money. For instance, in the last storm, we had to evacuate, and all the homeless had to evacuate as well. We put how many people in hotel rooms, costing Sutter County, I believe it was like 22, was it?
There was a total of 60.
A total of 60
people.
Okay, 60 in hotel rooms with animals in as well. And so we put them up for 2 weeks. Some people decide not to go, all right? So we house those people temporarily to get them out of harm's way. So they kind of got hit with a $250,000 cleanup bill in the river because all the homeless, because when you see couches and mattresses going down the river, somebody's got to clean that stuff up. And so we were had to encompass a $250,000 bill. We partnered with U County in trying to build a homeless shelter site off Garden Highway. And I'm not sure what the tune of that money is, but it's 43 beds. How much is that machine, you think?
A lot.
Millions?
Correct.
Millions. All right. So, you know, this is not, like I said, just a one-time fix all. And, you know, I would like to say that Ms. Chapman and all the other people that run that committee, you know, they were put with a tough task. I mean, to go out and look at all these sites, 14 different sites, and visit these sites and come back with a recommendation, that's a tough task at the hand, and they've done it with honor and integrity, and I just think you throw them a big round of applause for doing it right now. So. And the reason why I had Mr. Mendick put that thing on there about continuing the committee is it's important that we continue that committee. It's important for board supervisors to listen to this committee and take direction, you know, from all their hard work and I've said before, they need other resources. Let's give them those resources. Personally, for me, looking at a site, and I said a long time ago when we were looking at Whitaker Hall, and Whitaker Hall was taken off the table, I said at that time, the best site would be by U.S. Center Mental Health building. And I just feel that, once again, we provide a place of rest. That doesn't mean I'm opposed to, you know, looking at Glad Tidings. I just don't know the specifics on it and need more information and as far as, you know, the cost and how much it's gonna, you know, take to run a site at that particular area. But I think that we are also looking at partnering with other service organizations, such as the Salvation Army, has stepped up big for us. Other faith groups have come and asked for to be a part of this. I Hands of Hope, obviously, is a great organization that works in detail with these service groups. So I will strongly believe that we can continue working on a homeless management plan, and I think it's going to be a continued basis as we go on as well. So hopefully we can get buy-in from other jurisdictions. Like as we said, we've got buy-in from U County. City, I will tell you, not putting their heads in the sand, they're looking at their homeless issues as well. So I just want to make sure that that's clear. We definitely want to partner with our city council, most definitely. And I think the city council is very receptive to it as well. So we just have to sit down and have those discussions. It's in a preliminary stage right now, and hopefully we can get something done. Thank you.
Thank you, Supervisor. Janet?
Since you are commending us, I would like for the members of the ad hoc committee that are present to please stand. This is a very, very
participants in this conversation. So appreciate the time, and like I said, we're here. That's why we're here today. That's why you have two council members here, and also
In anticipation, we did have a specific discussion related to funding for a project on the board decided to move forward. So I appreciate the time, Steve.
No, thank you, Mr. Gale. Appreciate it. So,
does this not require an environmental impact report? Because if you do an interchange, it requires, you know, all kinds of paperwork.
Yes, I understand.
And that probably has less of an impact than something like this would, depending on where it's located.
Mr. Mitnick, can you answer the question on the environmental impact report?
Mr. Chair, members of the board, that's an excellent example of the type of work we'll have to do through due diligence analysis when we report back to the board in about 3 months. We'll articulate different steps and what type of planning steps and reviews would be necessary.
Okay. So they're going to look into it and find out. This tonight is about passing this proposal to go into further depth of research to look at these two locations to see if they will be viable at the end of the day. I don't want to repeat everything everyone said, and we've spent, I've been here for 3.5 years, and this has been the discussion on and on and on. And I've seen the proliferation and the growth of the issue. I visit my daughter down in San Francisco, and man, that's unbelievable what's going on down there, right? So, so we have to take an approach. Yes, there's no one solution, as you mentioned. If you look around the nation, it's hard to find any singular solution that's working. Actually, we haven't found one yet. We're not saying that these recommendations are going to be the end all to end the homeless issue, even in our community. But we are saying, and we are willing, and thank you to the support, especially of this committee that stepped up and held months of public meetings to do this research. We are saying that we are willing to take a leadership role as a county. And I'm very proud of this county at this moment that we're willing to step up and stand up and have this leadership. We're not going to all agree to everything that we come up with. That's just not going to happen. But we're willing to speak, we're willing to listen, we're willing to work together. I mean, what a testimonial to the whole nation that a community of 11 people would step up from the community and come to these meetings and show up and be there all the time and be able to provide information and listen to input from the rest of the community and come up with some potential solutions. Now, we don't even know if these two solutions will pan out now. This is just about now taking it to the next step and conducting the necessary due diligence that we have to do. So I for one, I want to ask the committee to stick around for a minute too. I have some little special for your whole committee as soon as we're done here with the passments, but if you would. But I'm just, like I said, it's a proud moment for me in that we're addressing the issue. We're not burying our heads in the sand, we're actually addressing the issue. I do want to thank the City of Yuba City for working with us, but I'd also like, when we pass this ordinance, I'd really like to direct staff to work directly with the staff of the City of Yuba City to work officially on this process, how we're going to move forward. I'd actually like to direct you to hold a meeting with, or multiple meetings, whatever it takes, to work closely with the city on this. And with that, I'd just like to entertain a motion.
I'd like to make a motion. I move that the Board of Supervisors recommend the staff that we take both sites and do the due diligence to research to find out the costs associated with building each facility, the environment that we're required to now, environmental impact report, et cetera, et cetera. And I would like to report back, not 3 months, but I would like to see something every month until we're done, and I'd like to see it done less than 3 months again. Thank you.
Okay, if we can back up just a moment, Supervisor, if we can first do a motion on item number 35, which is the approval of the ad hoc committee recommendation itself. And then, we're going to do a combined. Is that acceptable to combine the motion to item 35 and 36? Okay.
Yeah.
All right, that being said, then we have a motion from Supervisor Conan. Do I have a second? Okay, I have a second. First and second, all those in favor signify by saying aye, please.
Aye.
Any opposed or abstentions? Okay, there being none, the motion carries. Thank you. At this time, though, I'd like to ask Richard, thank you. Eric Mackison.
Thank you, Eric. Jamie McLeod. Christopher Monaco. Janet, we've recognized. Mike Morris. Okay, and then Eldon Benry's been to every meeting, I understand, too. So thank you, Eldon. Eldon's not here either.
Yeah,
not here, but thank you, Eldon. And if we could just give this group a round of applause.
People from different backgrounds, different perspectives, and coming together for common good of our hometown, where we all live. And, you know, sometimes it's important to agree, to disagree, have a smooth transition, and come down to something that's the best for all of us, including our homeless community. And as a representative of Yuba City right here today, I can tell you, we're looking forward to working closely with the county. We have some jurisdictions that overlap, some do not. To the extent where it's appropriate for us to fit in to that complex, very complex puzzle, as Supervisor Whitaker alluded to, if we have the answer, I tell you, we'd all be millionaires, because it is a complex issue. There is as many reasons why some of it's homeless as there is homeless people, and we have some of the more responsibility to help them out the way we can, and we also have a responsibility to our residents, who are literally, quite frankly, being victimized by some of these homeless people. They're coming, they're burglarizing the garages. They can't even just go about their day-to-day life without someone coming in and victimizing. That's unacceptable. So we're not here to coddle them. We are not here to be their way to use us. However, we do have a responsibility to do what we can as humanistic folks to help them get up back on their feet. And from the city, we fully intend and look forward to working closely with the county, our city manager, and CAO of Sutter County, Scott, to have those discussions, have those tough discussions, and come together where it's appropriate to move forward for a solution. And we have an opportunity, as with all every problem, an opportunity to be the gold standard for the entire country. If we could wrap our head around something and come in and think outside that box, and come up with something, we have an opportunity to really set the pace for everybody. And what the problem is, it takes this stuff, the greening stuff that we all want to part with, but we have to sometimes, and it's tough. But I think together, the proper attitude, you check your ego at the door, you come to the table with your palms up, you be honest, have some honest, frank discussions, and move forward. And I look forward to that, and hopefully the city can be a part of that, and I think we will. I think we're off to a great start.
All right, thank you, Councilman.
I'm actually monitoring the live.
certainly.
How are we doing this?
Good to see you. How are you?
That's pretty much what I want to do. Got it.
All right. Perfect.
Thank you. Thank you.
speaks, and I'd just like to make a couple of comments on this topic. This is a big topic. This is something that we've worked out and addressed from early on for the last several years. You know, we're dealing with a large number, and there's going to take a lot of work to make things work out right. But I guess the point I want to make right now is I want to sincerely thank the Auditor and Controller for his leadership that he's taken on this over the last few years. From even before he started in the office, there was a discussion on how we're going to tackle this issue. And from that time, we've been working on it. You know, and this is another one of those issues that's sort of like the homeless issue. There's no direct solution that we need to come up with immediately. It's going to be multiple solutions. And I, for one, just wanted to commend you, Mr. Black, and thank you for the work you've done on it. With that, it's your presentation.
Thank you kindly for that, Chairman and Supervisors. Also joined with Assistant County Administrator Steve Smith. We worked on this together, and we're approaching that as a team. And also, I want to just underscore or throw in with what you just described and say that I appreciate the conversation we've had since we both joined the county in 2014. And we've been talking about the pension ever since. And we will get to in a couple of minutes some of the positive things we have done already in that short time, and then also talk about some of the opportunities that exist still. And I want to say that I think we need to get a new microphone.
Yes.
This leading over to have a conversation is
all in favor.
Okay, so let's get the show on the road. Okay, so to begin, we'll just jump forward, and this is the agenda, and we're trying to keep this very what should be kind of a long, deliberate conversation to 15 minutes. So we'll come back, we'll talk more in a few months, but this is just to kind of get us going. It's also number 6 in the countywide top 10 priorities. So we're trying to meet those established by your board last year. Okay, so beginning with status and pension, I'm going to turn it over to Steve.
Good afternoon, Honorable Chair and Supervisors. Thanks for the opportunity to speak on this topic. Again, I've been working closely with Nate. He's incredibly knowledgeable on this subject, and just appreciate his input on this.
You can speak a little louder.
Okay, sorry about that. No, I'm really close. So above you'll see our debt, which is our total pension liability, the asset, total assets of CalPERS, which we have in the fund, and the UAL, which is our unfunded pension liability. So if you do a quick math, and we can probably just go ahead to the next slide.
Yeah.
So you'll see here we have $362 million invested at CalPERS, $1.3 million in PARS, which is our Section 115 of the IRS code, our irrevocable trust. And below the pension liability, again, the unfunded pension liability for a net funded status of approximately, check. Okay, now I don't have to lean over so far. Thank you. So we're approximately 70.7% funded. That does, as I mentioned, include our investment into PARS. We've put $1,250,000 into it since it's been a year and a half, approximately.
Yeah, just over a year, and we had about 8.5% yield from inception to date.
Okay, so we've gained about $70,000 in a year, which may sound like peanuts when you're looking at $514 million liability. However, that's a pretty solid return. CalPERS, on the other hand, they've got about $326 billion in assets, pension liability of $480 billion, total pension liability, unfunded portion is $154 billion. So they are at 68% funded, so we're slightly better than CalPERS. little part of that is due to our investment with the Mars.
Yeah, and just to highlight, that $1.3 million, we began that just a couple of years ago. So the Section 115 trust, $1.3 million, the second line, that's something that this board put in place doing that side funding, the Pension Rate Stabilization Trust. And not only did it have a good return, I want to see that thing build. We can diversify away from CalPERS. We control that PARS money that we set aside. And the final note is that 1.3 takes that funded status a little over 70%. So we're 70.7. And like Steve said, it may not seem like a lot of money, but actually we're teetering on 69% if we didn't do that. So all I'm saying is that even though these small tools, they don't look like they're having a significant impact over time, they will. And that's the beginning of what I think is going to be a big impact.
So, further on the status of the pension, just to give you some background, as I mentioned, approximately 70% funded. There's, we just checked yesterday, 3,005 total participants. 1,000 approximately are active. So what that means is the remaining 2,000 are either retired or with other agencies or in the private sector, et cetera. They're not contributing to the system at the moment. So these numbers that I'm going to follow with here are generated based upon CalPERS actuarial valuation of the county. And in the upcoming 18-19 budget, which will be presented to the board on June 12th, I believe, and we will have hearings on June 20th. For each position that's budgeted, non-safety, non-law enforcement, there's 26%, actually almost 26.5, put towards retirement. And for safety, almost 39%. So countywide, we have about $17.5 million budgeted just in the contribution to PERS. It's county contribution to retirement. The unfunded liability portion of that $17 million is $10.7 million. So approximately $6.8 million would be what our budget would be if it weren't for the unfunded liability versus 17.5, which is pretty significant. I went ahead and skipped forward a couple years. You can see CalPERS is estimating that we're going to go from 26% for position to 31%, and for safety up to 46%. The budget would need to be about $22.3 million. UAL, $3 million increase in just a couple years, 2 years. And then another 4 years ahead of that, so 6 years from now, 36 and 52%, and a budget of $28.6 million with a UAL payment making up 18.9 of that. So basically, two-thirds of the money going to CalPERS that year would be for the unfunded liability.
So, yeah, it's fine. That's the hurdle we have to jump over, right? We can actually put our finger on it. We have to get by 24, 25. And I'm not saying the year before or the year after aren't way better or way worse. They aren't way better, but that's kind of the severity of the situation. And so when you actually look at the numbers, wow, that is tough. 52 cents for every dollar of safety that we pay in salary when we get to 2024. 52 cents, that's enormous. So the challenges are there. Having said that, to put a positive spin on it, if we can plan for that and we can get through that, we will have resolved the largest part of this problem. Just merely staying afloat through that period is going to be the most difficult part. Yeah, and again, thank you for mentioning that. And that's assuming we don't have a catastrophic recession like we did in the 7-8-9 time frame. So let's talk about that for just a second. This is, it's maybe a touch hard to see, This will be on the website, of course, and I'm going to perhaps put it on my own website so that folks can access it, but you can always access it through the Board of Supervisors. This represents the unfunded pension liability over time, and we tried to capture a healthy amount of time so that you can see the volatility in the number. The number itself, pension liability, is an art to get to, so it's not a perfect science, I got to say that, but you can see, hello? Yeah, so we start off in 2001 on the left, and we grow to 2016 all the way to the right. And when we're below those years that are up there, that means that we're down at the, this is not working, down in the negative range. Negative means we actually had a surplus. We had more assets at CalPERS than we had a pension liability. So we had more money. That has flipped, and we've grown in a sort of not, So we've grown in a negative fashion to about 150 million, and that would be the top right corner of the chart. And then this is Sutter County's pension assets as a percentage of total liability. So what we were just looking at a minute ago was the actual liability, how much money. The unfunded liability, that is. And then on this chart, we're looking at, okay, so you've got this much in assets or cash and market securities, et cetera, down to CalPERS. Well, how much is that compared to the total debt of the pension plan? That's what this chart represents. So we began, like I said on that last slide, in superfunded land, and that shows 122%. And that was, again, in 2001. And over time, we've cut down to approximately, This chart shows 68.7%. I think we're a touch closer to 70% as the prior couple of slides was showing. And in part, that's because of the PARS money we set aside. So, well done. There's one more chart we want to show you, but we're going to bring it back to you next time. Very interesting. I just wanted to make sure we captured all that. Okay. So, moving forward. So, service delivery impacts. Approximately $9 million of the current fiscal year, so 17-18, approximately $9 million is the unfunded pension liability we sent down to Sacramento. And so why am I talking about this once again? You remember the slide back here, $10.7 million, bottom left. That's next year's unfunded pension liability. And then you see it grows as we go to the right, so skipping back forward. So the $9 million today, this fiscal year, you all would have to appropriate and spend on services, on reserves, et cetera, for the community. But unfortunately, we had to send it to CalPERS. So I was trying to kind of make that real world to you. If we didn't have an unfunded pension liability and we were only paying the quote normal costs for the pension plan growing, we would have $9 million to appropriate. Going forward, 10.7, climbing all the way to 19 million in 2024. So the issue isn't small. We could do a lot with that. Well, what's the service delivery impacts? Well, as you don't have that money available to appropriate and spend, we can't provide as many services as we would like. So when folks, undersheriff and sheriff, they're constantly talking about the need to have more deputies, and we've had a lot of conversation about that. Fire, likewise, has a lot of concerns with their fiscal status and funding. So this would provide, I think, a lot more capital for you all to resolve those issues with. So it is what it is, but we can still do things to make this lesser of a problem going forward in the future. So, specifically, we'd have more money available for capital projects, replacing vehicles, increased wages, and of course, increased number of positions to enhance or maintain service. And then finally, what some governments have felt is you get to a point and you can't pay it. You get to a point where that 52 cents on the dollar becomes too difficult, and so some jurisdictions have gone into insolvency with CalPERS, and what that's with the plan itself. And so that leads down to service insolvency, where you can't provide the core services to your constituency anymore. I'm going to just mention a couple of those examples so that you can look them up yourself. But here's four entities that have had problems with CalPERS in the last 2 to 3 years. The city of Boylton, the beneficiaries in the plan there had their pensions cut 60%. So instead of getting a dollar of pension, they only got 40 cents for every dollar they were expecting. East San Gabriel Valley Human Services Consortium, 63% cut. Trinity County Waterworks District number one, 69% cut. Finally, this will blow you away. If I'm getting it correct, the Neyland Sanitary District in Imperial County, 92.5%. I think that was only for two individuals, but nevertheless, those two individuals are only getting approximately 8 cents on the dollar for their pension. So it can lead to disaster for those folks, but that's why we're here, right? That's why we're here talking to you now, because I don't think that that's Sutter County's future at all. I think our future could be a lot more positive, but we just have to address it. That's all. We have to take prudent action.
Thanks, Dave. So our current challenges, I think you've heard enough about challenges, but let me go over what's caused some of this. You may have heard CalPERS reducing the discount rate. This one's cutting out as well. And that's been a 3-year process from 7.5% to 7%. So if you look, we were previously at 7.5% expected returns. Mic number three, I'm back. So we went from 7.5% to 7.375 to 7.25. So those are an eighth of a percent each. And then for 1920, you'll see it's a full 0.25%. So that's going to be a tough transition that year. And when CalPERS was considering these changes, researching it, and then the board was voting on what they should reduce the discount rate to, their outside consultant thought 6% was a more reasonable number. However, they went with 7%. I think part of that is because 6% would have been incredibly difficult for jurisdictions to handle. When you look at a half percent, or in that case it would have been a percent and a half, with a 7.5% original rate, you're looking at about a 20% drop. So it was quite severe.
Well, just to make sure everybody's aware, discount rate is the assumed yield that you're going to get over time. So when we send money to CalPERS, they're saying, hey, over time, the market, the assets that you're sending to us, we're going to put in the market. And when we do so, we estimate and conclude that we're going to average something like 7% or 7.5% every year for into perpetuity. So the point is CalPERS is saying, hey, we're no longer going to realize 7.5%. We're going to realize something closer to 7. Outside consultants say it's actually closer to 6. These slight changes, they seem small, they're huge. And the reason why they're huge is because the change impacts 50, 60 years of calculations. Every year you have $350 billion in the market at CalPERS. Billion with a B. So saying we're going to get 7% or even 6, that 1% on $350 billion is kind of a lot of money, something like $3.5 billion. So, wow, big change. 6% would have been, I think, catastrophic, and it wouldn't have been palatable to the employers. Amortization basis, what are we talking about here? So CalPERS made a change recently saying we're no longer going to amortize our bases over 30 years going forward. Beginning in 2019, we're going to amortize all of our bases over 20 years. What is this? Well, it's a methodology of smoothing. Smoothing what? Well, they're smoothing the impacts of these actual results versus what they expected. They're not taking in those differences all in the year that it happened. They're taking them in over 20 years. So this is important. The reason why I'm taking a moment to explain amortization rates is like, why? Come on, what do you care about that? Well, the reason being is it's truly, I think you can totally grab this. When we had last year, Scott, you can remind me, but we had 11.5% rate of return, right? Or 11.2. And we've talked about the S&P return 15.4. That's kind of interesting. But just focusing on that 11.2% rate of return at CalPERS for the 16-17 year, everybody's thinking, well, shoot, 11%, that's amazing. And it's great, it's good. But the reason why you don't see a huge drop in our unfunded pension liability or a huge drop in the amount of money we need to send to CalPERS next year is because of the smoothing, largely. It's because we're only recognizing that 11%, or actually the 4% above the 7% discount rate, confused yet? We're only recognizing the excess over 7% up to 11, 1/20th each year. So all of these changes get smoothed in. That's why it's very confusing when folks look at the numbers and they don't understand why the CalPERS figures go up or down like they do. It's largely because of this. Okay, so this is my possible solution slide, and then we're going to get to Steve's possible solution slide. They're all of our solutions, but we're just divvying it up. So this is my closing. We're watching Marin County very closely. I've identified and put in there three quotations that I found to be very useful in understanding what the Marin County situation is. So I'll just sum it up in a brief by saying that Marin County decided to take away and exclude some of the special pays that went into folks' base pay. And by doing that, they reduced what's called the PERSable salary. And so they're not a PERS agency, but it's the same concept. This is a 37 Act county. They have their own retirement system, the Marin County retirement system. So Marin County retirement system says, hey, these shouldn't have ever been included in your pay, we're taking them out. Well, that had an impact on people, so the union sued. And the district court and the appellate court both affirmed in the county's favor, saying that, and here's where we get into, for example, the second quote. Oh, we'll just start with the first, excuse me. So district court ruling, the defendant, quote, did not act impermissibly to exclude specified I don't know why these mics are killing me today. Specified items, categories of compensation. Yes. Okay. All right, I'm wrapping it up. So second quotation, while a public employee, this is my favorite quotation. I just think it's cut right to the chase. While a public employee does have a vested right to a pension, myself included, that right is only a reasonable pension. The reasonable is the key word there, okay? So it's not an immutable entitlement. It needs to be reasonable, and I think the governing body of the jurisdiction, in this case, Marin County Retirement System, was able to make that call. So what we're doing right now is we're waiting for the state Supreme Court to weigh in on this, and what the state Supreme Court is doing is they're waiting on a couple of other cases that are being tried below them to see how they end, and then they're going to bring all four, I think, of the cases together and rule at once. Finally, these last two things, SB 681, public employees retirement. That was a bill that Senator Morlock from Orange County had last year. I think it's dead now, but I like that bill because it allows for people to break away without all the penalties. PEPRA is a pretty solid bill. It's impacted everybody in the state. It's a state law, and it's reduced the how large the pensions can be for an individual. So it's capped it at a, quote, reasonable rate. Myself, I am on PEPRA because I was hired after January 2013. Well, I wasn't hired, but, you know.
Okay, final slide, and I'll just say possible solutions. We're already contributing to CalPERS. At PARS, we're getting a solid return. We think we should maintain that. We think we should continue to prepay our unfunded liability at the beginning of the year, which was, I believe, an idea Nate brought forward to us and saved us about $300-some thousand, if I'm correct,
$340,000.
continue to attend CalPERS meeting, board meetings, voice our concerns, and I believe we should develop a pension pre-funding policy, even though we've been pre-funding, maybe to establish some recommended range of funding each year as possible, and maintain that within the Board of Supervisors' top 10 priorities as an issue. Thank you very much, and we're open for any questions.
Thank you, Steve.
Okay, thank you, gentlemen. Bring this back to the board for any questions. Yes, Supervisor. Look at the lights.
So first of all, I'd like to thank you guys for all the hard work. This is something I've been concerned about for years. I was scared of this problem because you could see the light was been happening over the last 10 years about the time unfunded liability grown. Isn't it true that this last year, because of the lowering of the discount rate, raised the liability to the county, and in effect, negatively affecting our budget by almost $1 million, Steve?
Good question, Supervisor. I would have to calculate the difference that, between the 7.5 and it didn't go down to 7, it just went down a quarter percent. So I'd have to look, and I can give you that number, or we can bring back the next presentation as well and show you what the dollar amounts are. I have the overall dollar impacts, but I don't have by percent.
And maybe this question is better than me. You talk about the how the pensions are funded through CalPERS, or their investments that are not necessarily maybe to the rest of the community about. So, for example, they don't invest in certain funds and sectors of the investment fund to have a good mix. They invested in funds like tobacco, firearms, limited alcohol, those kinds of things. Talk about that.
Yeah, you're referring to divestments. Great question, and it's a big concern. Since 1986, the CalPERS board has participated in this idea of divestment. And what they do, or what has occurred over time, is ESG, environmental, social, and governance, has surpassed fiduciary responsibility in the CalPERS board. So they have prized political causes above their fiduciary role. That's my opinion. I think it's also supported by fact and history, but that's a real scathing indictment. We've lost about $9 billion since 1986 because of that terribly, terrible policy. And as the assistant CIO shows me frequently, or reminds me very smartly, the CalPERS own policy, their very first, I forget what the list is called, but their very first item on this list is fiduciary responsibility to seek the highest yield. 50, 60 rows down, they talk about environmental, social, and governance, you know, political issues. It's really unfortunate.
And the last one for me, the spoofing that you spoke about, ends up, one of the reasons why they do that is to smooth out the past poor performances. And a lot of that might be influenced by the fact they invested in for example, in four times, I call them the sin taxes, do well. For example, tobacco, firearms, alcohol, do bad in poor performing periods of the market. But the smoothing helps hide those losses and smooth out that loss for those years. But of course, the good years, it flattens those good years out.
Right, takes the peaks and valleys away.
Right.
Yes. And it also kicks the can down the road because it's a slower recognition period. So you don't realize the differences over expectations until far down there. There was one thing I was just saying, excuse me, and then please jump right back in, but I forgot to mention that the CAO and I took a trip down to Sacramento together and met with the chief actuary at CalPERS. And the reason why you just brought up divestment, so I played a little bit of bad cop. Scott was on the white horse and all that. And
But I asked the chief actuary very pointedly, you know, what the heck is going on with divestment? How in the world are you guys not investing in very lucrative stocks, you know, at our expense, a taxpayer expense and employer expense? And the chief actuary stunned me. Because I'm looking for a fight, you know, and I want change. And the chief actuary says, oh, I agree with you. I agree. And I told him that's not what he's supposed to say. Took the wind out of my wings. So what he was saying, and this is so key though, he was saying, it's not us, we're staff, it's the board. Please come down here, Scott, please jump in. He said, come down here and make your voices heard. And he mentioned how many times the gentleman from Southern California, the union president of the Police Officers Association, I can't remember the name of the...
I think it was Corona?
Yeah, I think you're right.
And my last point of thought, I think the PARS investment is a great thing because, first of all, it gets us off of that horse that, I mean, not all the way, but at least a little bit off of the horse that CalPERS has put us on. And gives us another option to invest money where maybe we have a better return. At least we don't have all our eggs in that basket. Thank you.
Thank you.
Do you want to comment on the PARS investment? Or?
You don't.
I didn't know if you had something else to say.
I appreciate it.
Any other questions from the board? Okay. Questions from CAO's office? Thoughts?
Mr. Chair, members of the board, thank you for allowing us to make this presentation. I just wanted to make some big picture comments because the audience for this issue is quite large, not just the folks here, not just the members of the community and the board, but we also have our employees and our labor groups. And this is a very healthy discussion. We appreciate the opportunity to be transparent. Also like to comment and make the observation that what you're seeing today is you're seeing your auditor controller's office and the county administrator's office working very closely together. I think that's important to acknowledge that. We appreciate the leadership from Nate Black, our auditor controller, but we also have other members of the executive team that have been helpful. Our treasurer, Steve Herra, for example, he's not here today. He's dealing with another issue, but he's been helpful. The entire executive team has come together very nicely. We've had a number of discussions where we talk very openly about our budget, our finances, and the pension challenges. So I don't think any of our department heads can say they're not in the know about what's happening, and by extension, we're doing that with the board. So this is a very difficult issue, and we're not trying to be alarmists, but we're trying to be realistic. And what we're sharing with the board, it comes down to, I think, and I missed the beginning of the presentation, but it just comes down to something very simple. If you think about having a mortgage or living in an apartment, having a rent payment, if your rent or your mortgage is going up, if you have an adjustable mortgage, it's going up at one rate, but your income is not keeping up with it, it becomes very difficult to make those payments. That's exactly what's happening with the pension bill every year for us. Our revenues are not growing at the same pace. So we hope, I appreciate the opportunity to speak here because I hope our unions are watching or at least watch the tape. We want to work in partnership with our employees and sit down with them and figure out how we're going to get through these challenges and not have to work against the employees. I've been in other organizations where we were able to do that. So we're going to embrace the opportunity to talk to our employees about that. And also just to mention, we are not alone in this local government. Our friends in Cuba City and hundreds, if not thousands, of local governments up and down the state are dealing with this very issue. This then results in the paradigm shift that we're in the process of going through in terms of services we provide and how we deal with our finances. So we're at the early stages of that shift. I don't know where we're getting pinged up, but mark my words, whoever is sitting in your seats or these seats, 3, 5, 10 years down the road, will be making very difficult decisions. But it's not the end of the world. We're just going to have to look for the hidden opportunities that are out there that we just don't see right now. So thank you for allowing for the opportunity to be here today.
Thank you, Mr. Mendick. And I just want to close by thanking Auditor Controller again for his leadership and working closely together, as Mr. Mendick mentioned, we mentioned early on in the presentation, working closely together with the CAO's office. And this is a big issue, as we talked about at the beginning, and to tackle it is commendable. And again, Sutter County stepping up to the leadership side of that and making that work. You know, that's, and I just want to add too, thank you to the board for making this a top priority in the board agenda. And this is a priority that we will continue, I'm sure, to keep as one of our top priorities in addressing. And we look forward to the continued work that you do. And bring that back. You said the next report in.
Yeah, I was thinking of them in quarterlies. I mean, it says semi-annual, so at least twice a year, but there's so much to kind of discuss, and if we could take a bite at a time, maybe that would be a better approach, maybe in 2 or 3 months come back.
Okay, let's plan on a quarterly, and that sounds really good.
Thank you. Thank
okay.
you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I have a few items, and then a ceremonial item that is mandatory that we will do. So let me point out no additional follow-up, I believe, from today's meeting. I'd like to point out a few things that are coming up. On Friday, our county gets to host the SACOG, Sacramento Area Council of Governments, their called RUCS, that's the Rural Urban Connections Strategy. It's part of their Land Use and Natural Resources Committee. They're gonna have a special meeting up in our county, close to where Vice Chair Matt Conant resides in his business. So they're coming up to look at some of the innovative and unique operations on his property as an example for others, I believe, to emulate or to something like that. I know you're a little embarrassed by it, but we got the entire Sacramento region, we got representatives from different governments coming to take a look at that. That's something to be acknowledged. We lead by example in many instances, and that is something I want to point out where to go. I don't have it in front of me, our behavioral health department is, I shared with the board, is being recognized nationally by the National Civs Association, it's associations of counties. Or it's a joint county effort between the county and Sutter County Behavioral Health with the emergency, I don't know by memory. So the psychiatric services we provide at the hospital, the emergency room, we've already received statewide recognition, but we found out today we're getting national recognition, and our supervisors have been invited to go to the annual conference in Nashville to receive the award. I think we have two, the chair and Mr. Munger, are you going? Two of you are going, and we'll have definitely representatives from Nancy's department, but the staff that work out there have done a tremendous job. This is something to be really proud of, and our appeal democratic order stepped out, and hopefully we can work with her to get some good coverage on that. That's a really cool deal. We'll put it on the county's website, so Nancy, congratulations. Okay, we do have Mother's Day coming up on the 13th, so I'm going to make a note of that. For those who don't have cards yet, you might want to get those and take care of that. I also want to give an update to the board. One of the board supervisors asked me to do this. The refuse collection contract negotiations for 5 of the 6 local governments in the Bi-County area, they've been continuing and they're going very well. And the staff level, and we'll continue to do that. We hope to be in front of the RWMA and then eventually the 5 governing bodies in the next couple months. But it's moving along in a nice way. And I just wanted to mention that to you. And then this week, May 6th through the 12th, this is Public Sector Recognition Week throughout the country. And Sutter County is celebrating and partaking in that tomorrow. We'll have our employee fiesta picnic. Not tomorrow. So it's tomorrow, and we're going to be celebrating that for the employees. And board, we have a record number of employees who are going to participate in that. So we have 645 employees who are participating in that. And then finally, we would like to recognize our board chair for his birthday. A little something here from your executive team and employees in the county administrator's office, a little card, and everybody's favorite cookies from Cookie Tricks. So we'll open this here.
Thank you. happy birthday. We'll take that. I really appreciate the barn and the gesture. I turned 74. Okay, we're going to move right on. Thank you for your comments, Mr. Mendick. And now we'll move on to any considerations that you need.
Yes, I have one. Lee Massey, he grew up here in the city. He just passed away. He worked for Water Resources for 30 years. He was a great guy to work with out in Sutter, New York. And I'd like to have a representative of his stud on.
Okay, do you have a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, we'll send that out. Thank you. Supervisor Solinger.
Yes, I have one. A name. Grundy. A little personal story about Minnie Grundy. She and her husband owned at the foot of Bridge Street, Johnny's Quick Lunch. When I first met her, she was my elementary school teacher in 7th and 8th grade. And that was a couple of years ago. Fast forward 50 years. I'm stepping out to the tee to play golf one day. 50 years later, and I see this lady that's getting ready to tee off in front of me. Guess who it was? Minnie Grundy. She was quite a lady. She lived to be 97 years old. Her obituary was pretty self-explanatory about her life, but over the years she had made a number of contributions, and as I say, it's gratifying to be able to see your elementary school teacher lived to the ripe old age of 97, and I recently had a conversation with her. Amazing lady. So I appreciate our recognizing and closing in her memory.
Second. Thank you, Supervisor. I have a second from Supervisor Whitaker. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, thank you. Supervisor Cummings?
Yes, I'd like to close the memory of Barbara John Bargman. Died in April 24th. He attended Mark Bellinger School, East Texas High School, played football for that school. Marvin served in the Army, U.S. Army from 1965 to 68, and then he married his wife Charlotte in 1969. He settled in Pleasant Grove and began farming. He was laid to rest on May 4th, and I'd like to close the memory for him. Thank you.
Thank you, Supervisor. I have a second. Second from Supervisor Whitaker. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you. Supervisor Whitaker.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I have time to close the memory of Alvin Bill Myers passed away. And so, Bro attended Sutter High School and was active in agriculture. He served in the Army in World War II. He was also a farmer and heavy equipment operator. Trade. Bro was married to Mary Blair, and he loved farming, animal farming, and he was a proud member of the Operating Engineering Service and the Friendly 4-H Club as a board. He was also a 4-H leader for District 10 and he was 4-H Club. And the family advised donations for Bro's ninja, et cetera, and FA. So this guy was just a quality of a gentleman. First class, by the way, so condolences to his family. As well as Harold Lee Hara, he was born on December 29th, 1930, at his family farm in Indiana to Louise and Edith Hara. After graduating from high school, he married his high school sweetheart, Irene, and joined the U.S. Air Force. They lived in Florida, England, and eventually made their home in California. Harold, she ranked a master sergeant serving as a crew chief in the 9th OMS at Baylor Air Force Base in the SR-71 program. Harold was known for his intricate skills as a mechanic and machinist. He would repair any machinery and household appliances, fabricating many of his own replacement parts. He prided himself in his garage organization and enjoyed spending time with design and woodworking. After retiring, he spent time learning and expanding on his computer skills so he could stay in close communication with family and friends. He is also the father of our treasurer tax collector, Mr. Steve Harris.
a second?
Okay.
All those in favor?
Aye.
That passes. All right, I have no further comments. Are there any further comments from anybody else on the board or staff?
I'd like to take a minute and listen to Dan. Happy birthday.
Oh.
Okay. Happy birthday to
to take one for Team D2 and run block for you and take them cookies off your hands so you don't have to worry about your diet.
Happy to share them with you. Thank you. Good night, everybody. Appreciate it.